Hello. Can people hear me? I must say it's a little disconcerting to have everybody have headphones on. It makes you look like you're listening to your favorite track and not to me. But anyway, welcome. I'm really pleased that there's so many people here. My name's Brett Solomon. I'm the executive director of Access, accessnow.org. Our job is to defend and extend the digital rights of users at risk. Excuse me. We've started. Sorry, we're started. Yeah, we're starting, yeah. So has everyone got headphones on? Great. All right, so as I said, my name's Brett Solomon. I'm the executive director of accessnow.org. We defend and extend the digital rights of users at risk. I'm very pleased to be here surrounded by such an illustrious panel. just working my way from left to right, we have Vint Cerf, who is the man waving, also known as the father of, co-father of the internet. we have Elvin Mejidov, who is from Azerbaijan. We have Alon Barr, who is from the Odyssey Project, but is here in his own capacity. We have Richard Allen, who is the policy director for Facebook. And then we have Alice Munua, who is from the Kenyan government. So when we talk about multi-stakeholderism, I think we have a pretty good selection of people. we have government, we have civil society, we have technicians, we have academics, and we have companies. And we have all of you. We would like to make this discussion as interactive as possible. So we won't have presentations from the panelists, but we'll have a series of questions and comments. I'd like to actually just start on a somber note, if that's okay. I was Skyping with an Iranian colleague last night who sent me a link on one of their websites to announce that Sattar Beheshti, who is a cyber activist and a labor activist in Iran, who was detained on the 30th of October, was found dead last night in Elvin prison in Tehran. He was arrested by Iran's cyber police. And his sister was called and told to come and pick up his personal belongings. His computer and his handwritten notes, which were also confiscated, were not part of those belongings on return. So just a moment just to reflect upon that whilst we're here. So as you know, this panel is asking the new question, I think, which is not whether human rights apply online, but whether access to the internet itself is a human right. And I think we have, as I say, a fantastic panel to be able to discuss that. There are diverging views, which is great, on the panel. We're not going to be in furious agreement. There's certainly a sense that, for many, that access to the internet is a human right because human rights are something that people deserve and enjoy by the very nature of being human. Others would say it's an enabling right. And there are many implications, of course, of something being announced or being codified as a right. It puts an obligation on the state. It's an opportunity for advocacy, etc., for citizens. It puts additional pressures on companies. And we're really here to kind of tease some of those questions out. I think many of you know that Vint Cerf wrote an opinion piece in the New York Times, which caused quite some controversy. Alice, on my right, has been working with the Kenyan government trying to bring access to the communities within urban areas as well as rural areas. Facebook has 1 billion users, and I'm sure 960 million of them probably see access to Facebook as a human right. But let's start with Alon Barr, because Alon is a specialist on this issue, and he's going to lay the groundwork for us so that we can kind of have a sense, a shared sense of the platform in which we're operating and the issues that we're discussing. So, Alon, over to you.
Thanks, Rest. Can you all hear me? Great. Hi, everyone. As Brett mentioned, the internet is quite important to all of us. That's why we're sitting here. And I think by now over 2 billion people use the internet. And that's a great number. But at the same time, about 2/3 of the world does not access the internet. So that brings about a huge question. Do people have the right to access the internet? And what I just want to do in this very short talk is basically outline the four dimensions that I think are most important to keep in mind when we're thinking about this issue. The first dimension is there a right for people to not be denied internet connectivity? In some cases, in some countries, people are not allowed to go online. In some cases, in some countries, to name, for example, France, Ireland, people can be deprived of their internet connection if they are in repeated violation of copyright laws. So that not being deprived is one part of a right to access the internet. Another part is if states have an obligation to actually provide people with internet access. So a right to internet access can also entail that specifically. A third dimension to think of when we're thinking of, well, what would a right to access actually mean, is thinking how does the internet connectivity work for people? Do they access it from their home computer? Do they access it from public library? Do they use a mobile phone? Do they have privacy while they access the internet? So all these things are really important if you think, well, you can have internet access, but what sort of internet access do you have? And that is also, involved with the fourth dimension that I want to mention, meaning what do people get access to? There is the internet, but as we all know, what the internet is in one country may be different in another country. So if you have a right to access the internet, but internet is filtered in your country, that has grave consequences for the sort of internet connectivity that you have. So those are basically the four dimensions that I think we should all have in mind when we talk about this issue. Thank you.
And Alon, or actually anybody here in the room, what actually is a human right? Anybody want to answer that? Why don't you start?
It's a good question. I believe a human right is something that every human being on Earth is entitled to have. And human rights are given to people by laws. There are legal instruments, there are treaties that provide people with, for example, a right not to be tortured, a right to freedom of expression, which is a very important right. And these rights are a part of a body of human rights treaties, for example, the Universal Declaration of Human Rights and other covenants.
I wonder whether the concept of human rights has actually evolved with time. Alice, what do you think about, your definition of human rights, and do you think that the concept of human rights has actually evolved as society around it has evolved?
Thank you. I think from a Kenyan or African perspective, I think it continue to be evolving. Although for us, obviously, especially back to the question whether internet access is a human right, coming back to that question, I would say that for many of us, we are still learning to consider, just the basic human rights as human rights. Extending that then to internet access is something that we haven't, we've started discussing it, especially at the national level. It's not something that has gained that level of awareness yet.
And what about the perspective of the Kenyan people? Have you got any sense of where they sit on the spectrum of the achievement of human rights and the enjoyment of, or even just knowledge of human rights to begin with, and then whether they would consider access to the internet as a human right?
I think they would consider access as a human right, and I'd let my permanent secretary here, Dr. Bitange Ndemo, actually respond to that, because he's on record on quite a number of spaces saying that we may want to actually in the future begin to consider it from that perspective. So
I'd be very pleased. I would be very pleased to hear from the permanent secretary. Welcome to the panel.
If you take, for example, the use of mobile in terms of money transfer, if you stop it for one day, it will be it will be chaos throughout the country. If you look at specific uses of internet for specific activities, it becomes a serious human rights issue. But in Kenya, we have gone a step further. In the next few, I think 2 to 3 years, we would guarantee at least 1 meg to every household. This is because of disparities in education that we can be able to solve, especially in deep rural areas. Now that becomes a serious human rights issue because we have been denying, when we have technology to provide this knowledge, we are capable of doing it now, and we must ensure that everybody accesses internet. So we have agreed with operators that at least 1 meg be guaranteed to every citizen. And from there now, others can be able to pay for whatever they can pay. Thanks.
So to interpret that, Permanent Secretary, would you say that in your opinion that access to the internet is a human right or an emerging human right?
It is a serious human rights issue. When you talk about disparities and a technology to help you remove those disparities to the majority, it means that it is a serious human rights issue.
So I think what we're hearing here is that access to the internet is essential for people to be able to live a full and secure and dignified life, and increasingly so. And I wonder, we heard the point that was made here about access to mobile phones and therefore to commerce, to economy. There would be chaos, you said, if people weren't able to do their mobile banking. And so I think we look at a number of the other rights as well, like the right to citizenship, and we think about e-governance, or the right to healthcare, and we think about mobile health, or we think about the right, of course, to freedom of expression and the information that's contained. So, Richard, do you think that that people actually need access to the internet in order to live a full and complete and dignified life?
Thanks, but yeah, I think very much so. I mean, you asked about the history of the evolution of human rights. And I think certainly from a European perspective, the great body of work was done as a reaction to the Second World War and the abuses that took place across the continent then. And so our body of law was started to be derived in the 1950s and then was subsequently defined. And it did define a series of rights for which now the exercise of those rights involves, for most people, access to the internet. So those are rights like your economic, social and cultural rights. So in the case of the Kenyan example, it's clear that you have a right to carry out economic activity. If being deprived of the internet means you can no longer carry out that economic activity, then there's a case for saying that the deprivation itself has deprived you of another right. You have rights to civil and political activity. So I think the interesting question for me would be, if we were drawing up that code now, what would we say? And so actually some of the, and again, I think human rights legislation typically comes out of a shock reaction. Something awful has happened in a country or a continent. And as a response in the, if you like, the rebuilding process, we create a local version of widely defined international standards. I was very interested in the discussions we had in Kenya at the IGF last year in what was happening in some of the North African countries that have similarly been through a shock, a political shock, and are now incorporating a 2012 version of human rights legislation into their national law, and the extent to which that will incorporate internet access. Because I certainly think if we were drawing up the rights that we drew up in the 1950s today, we would make reference to the internet or communications technologies in the context of all these other rights.
So, as I plug my computer in and ensure my access, and the green lights come on, which is good, let me throw to Vint Cerf. Vint, needless to say, we're very honoured to have you here on the panel. And I actually want to pick up on a particular point that Richard mentioned before, which is about the deprivation of rights, or the deprivation of the right capacity to access the internet. I won't say the right, the capacity to access the internet. Do you think that there perhaps is, in your opinion piece, you talked about that governments, I think, should not have the right to be able to take that access away. Where do you stand on that concept of not positive right, like the obligation of the state to provide, but the duty of the state not to take away?
So thank you for helping me through this. He and I have been arm wrestling for quite some time on this point. I continue to resist the idea that internet itself should be a human right, and I have two reasons for this. The first one is it sounds egotistical for me to even suggest such a thing. But the second reason is that I think of this, and then I ask myself questions like, is electricity a human right? Now, I have to tell you that when the electricity went out during the Hurricane Sandy, where I live in the Washington area, my most interesting, the thing I was most interested in was fire. So I could cook and see, and I began to appreciate how fundamental fire was to civilization. I do agree that where internet is available, and you could afford it, and you were denied access to it, there's something seriously wrong. I mean, this becomes, I like your terminology, that would be a human rights issue from my point of view, because you would have been prohibited from exercising a more fundamental notion of the right to express, have access to information, and to assemble. I'm very comfortable with a formulation like that. I'm less comfortable with the requirement to or obligation to provide. However, I'm very comfortable with the goal to provide. And I would distinguish a goal from an obligation or some natural human right. I think that we should all have the obligation to find ways for everyone on the planet to get access to the internet at whatever speed we can manage, because picking a number is always wrong. At Google, we think access to internet should start at a gigabit per second. But 10 years ago, that might have been an unreasonable goal.
So just thinking about what it means if access to the internet was determined to be a human right, thinking about the human rights framework more broadly, what does that actually entail? It means that the state must respect that human right, i.e. they need to refrain from interfering with a person's enjoyment of that right. It means that the state has to also protect the right, so protect others from infringing upon that individual's ability to be able to enjoy the right. And then they also have to take a positive step as well, which is to fulfill that right, which means that they have to take positive actions to ensure that their citizens are able to enjoy it. What about the idea of the company? What role might the company, the corporate, have in providing access? And I throw to Richard on that. Do you think that Facebook feels any obligation, duty, etc.? And if we think about the Ruggie framework as well, what does that mean for Facebook in ensuring access?
So I think for a service like ours, I think the best analogy I've come up with is that we're something like a hotel. It's a space that people can freely walk into. It would be wrong for us to behave in a discriminatory way in the context of general human rights and equality regulation in terms of who can come into our hotel. But the space inside the hotel is generally governed by the rules of the hotel that exist within that public law framework. And so I think there is another, it's just a reality that there is another layer of rules on top of the public law, or that sits within the public law, that platforms operate. And there are reasons for that. I mean, it is actually part of the joy of the internet that we have ended up with a space within which there are many competing platforms for people to do similar tasks or brand new tasks that no one had ever thought of. And that has been dependent on people trying different models. And so there is a risk in dragging public law or trying to define at a legislative level too much what happens within those platforms if they choose to have a legal code that is consistent with public law, driving out the ability of internet platforms to develop their own code, their own culture, their own methods of operation, and then have others come along and develop a different one, and then try and attract people across from one to the other.
I'm very keen to hear from Elvin, but Vint has just put up his hand, so I'd like to just get a response.
Just a very brief observation. This is an interesting discussion, and the analogy of hotel draws my thought to some rules in some parts of the world where if you go to a restaurant, they are obligated by law to supply you with water if you ask for it. They're in California, at least. I don't know if that's true in the rest of the United States. But that was an interesting kind of invasion into the interior of a private space. But that's because those are considered public institutions, and public institutions have obligations.
So, and I was going to say, I think there is some of that. I mean, I think the way in which the platforms behave does have the equivalent of providing water. I think we end up in that space. But government doesn't decide the decor or the range of drinks that you serve in the bar. So.
Hang on, did we just get agreement between Facebook and Google?
Well, we'll try to undo that later in the conversation.
You saw it here. So let me hand over to Elvin, because Elvin, I think that Vint is essentially saying that access to the internet is a serious human rights issue. What about from an Azerbaijani perspective? Can you give us a sense of, from your own perspective and also more broadly, where do you think the people sit on this issue, whether access to the internet is a human right?
Well, thank you, Brett. I understand that this is not a very long established concept. Is access to internet a human right or not? But Universal Declaration of Human Rights did not specify internet, because at that time we didn't have any internet. But if it were at that time, I'm sure that we could have. Because when you talk about the internet, what is internet? It's all about access. Let's say it is given. There is somewhere internet, but you cannot have any access to it. You cannot use this precious thing for your own benefit, for social economic development and personal development and so on. So, resultantly, access turns out to be a direct right, like right to get the information, seek information, receive information, and share the information. Therefore, it's a very crucial and human right, and maybe emerging human right. Maybe we'll see some legal texts in some decades, but I'm sure it is. It's definitely a human right. Access to internet, a human right. Well, from the Azerbaijani perspective, merely providing access to internet is. If you're asking question like whether we have good access to internet in Azerbaijan or not, I think we don't have great problems regarding that, because we have broadband internet, dial-up internet, and everywhere in each household, if it financial efforts, can purchase internet and connect to that. The issue is rather the information skills, like affordability, and also whether the person is able to use the internet collectively or privately. This one is the issue, and I think when we talk about such kind of things, we have to have a holistic account of access to internet human right embedded in the socio-economic context of a country, because let's say we have everything regarding access. I mean, country provides a lot of things for access, policy, institutional, legal framework, but the person cannot financially afford to buy it, and his or her capacities to use the internet are very low. So in that case, I think it's another obligation of the country, obligation, not a sort of luxury, to provide for the citizens education at schools, at universities, because particularly in the cases like access to water and access to internet gets identical to each other in a situation where you have where you have to use the internet. If you don't use the internet, you will lose something. So it's like this. Maybe you won't lose your life, or maybe you'll lose your life. It can happen, of course. If you don't drink water in a particular moment, and you need if you don't drink and you'll die. If, in very particular case, you die because you didn't have any access to internet, it means the direct violation of your rights. And I think it is, notwithstanding particular cases, and very special cases like death and existence, access to internet is definitely a human right, because internet without access is nothing.
Okay. So I'm not sure if many of you know about the BBC GlobeScan poll from 2010, which essentially asked the world's people. I think over 35 countries were simultaneously surveyed, and the outcome was that four out of five of the world's people believe that access to the internet is a human right. So I wonder if there's actually a disconnect going on here. And I should just say also that also includes people who don't have access to the internet as well. It wasn't just people who have access to the internet. And I'm looking forward to seeing the follow-up poll, which hopefully will happen next year. But so in a way, maybe we have a citizen who's suggesting that it certainly is, a government here that says it's a serious human rights issue. And both companies, I think, not of the opinion that necessarily access to the internet is a human right now. Maybe it's an emerging right. What about from the audience? Does anybody want to? Yeah. Let's hear from this fellow here with the. Yep. Can we get a microphone? And I think what we'll just do now is take the temperature from the room for a moment, and then we can pick up on some further issues.
Thank you. My name is Margiono from Indonesia. I have an NGO named Indonesia Online Advocacy. I think internet is human right, not in sense that everybody born to be connected, because we are not connected since we are baby, but we know that human rights is a growing concept. We know that currently we know about the third generation of human rights, like LGBT rights, was not recognized as human rights several years ago. But today, LGBT is recognized as a right of sexual orientations. It's new rights. But my question is, is the concept of internet as human right is different with the concept of universal access? Because we have been long time known that in telecom concept that access to telecommunication is recognized as universal access. The universal access concept is, I think, it's different with human right concept, because universal access concept saying that everybody has right to access an affordable telephone access. So there is no state obligations, but the obligation of company to provide affordable service everywhere people can be connected to the telephone. Thank you very much.
Yep. We'll take another comment up the back there. And also we have some questions from, a couple of questions from people out, online, okay. What? Yep, go on.
I'll stand just to be more visible. So I'm Vivek Krishnamurthy, I'm a lawyer, and my concern with making the internet a human right is that there's a tendency to clothe many things that are good in the world, like food, like water, healthcare, in rights language. But calling something a right doesn't really help, because one of the fundamental principles as a lawyer is that you need to have a remedy to make a right worthwhile. So categorizing water, for example, as a right has done nothing whatsoever to improve access to water and sanitation. It's the affirmative. The only thing it does is to create a sort of normative discourse around the need to improve access to water or sanitation. So it creates a political impetus, but that's independent of classifying the actual thing as a right. So I'm concerned about you know, cheapening rights by declaring everything to be a human right.
Okay. Anybody who doesn't want to ask
How's that
a
for
question,
a provocation?
Anybody who doesn't want to ask a question, can you put your hand up? Just because there's like 40 hands up. Vivek, I'd be interested to know on what basis you say that naming something as a human right or acknowledging it as a human right is not an impetus to the achievement of that right. And I think that if you look at many issues from the right to freedom of expression to the right to healthcare to sexual orientation, etc., it has, I would argue, given civil society an extraordinary platform from which to advocate for the achievement of that right. And also within the human rights framework, there's many indicators, many committees, etc., that review a state's activities against its human rights obligations, which pushes states to the achievement of that right.
Right. No, I completely agree with you that there are mechanisms that exist to ameliorate state conduct, right? My concern is kind of a definitional concern about what's really a right. So let's take a classic right like freedom of expression or gay rights, which are a newer species of right, but which build off an older concept, which is the right to be treated equally. So the normative content of the right there is a right to be free from some kind of unequal treatment or to be free from a particular kind of governmental treatment. And those kinds of rights are easily justiciable. It's easy to go to court and say, look, I've been mistreated on a particular kind of basis. I deserve uniform treatment. The problem with rights language, as I see it as a lawyer, when it comes to positive obligations to things, is that one can make that decision within a particular national community that healthcare or education or water should be a right, and you create a mechanism. But at the international level, beyond these very loose review mechanisms, there's very little substantive content to it. So that's my concern.
Okay.
I think we should call it something else.
Okay. Have we only got one microphone in the room? We have two. Okay. Can we have the... can we bring this one around? Okay. So you're next.
I will be brief.
Okay. Thank you very much. If everyone could keep their comments brief, that would be
very much appreciated. If we agree with you that access to the internet is a human right, what are you doing now of our human rights? You are abusing us since we arrived here. We have no internet access.
I would just like to take the moderator's privilege for a second to say that I haven't organized the internet access here. And I am an independent moderator without a perspective on whether access to the internet is a human right. So, Wolfgang, just one moment. We have a point over here. Again, if you could keep your comments very brief, that would be appreciated.
You know, so they're my professor. Okay, I'm teaching international law at University of Graz. My name is Wolfgang Benedek, and I have done some work on this. That's why I would like to intervene. I think that this is a conceptual issue which we are debating, and it reminds me very much of the debate whether economic, social, cultural rights are considered human rights. Yeah. United States has not ratified this convention. 160 states have. At the moment, a protocol is about to be ratified, which gives also the opportunity of individuals to complain of violations of such rights. So even this justiciability is not the issue. What is important, I think, in this context is that we can quite easily, as lawyers, derive from other existing rights, like freedom of expression, like right to education and so on, the need for the existence of such a right to access. And we have heard several dimensions. One additional dimension would be the issue of non-discrimination, which is also relevant for business, for example. You would not like to discriminate in the access to human rights. And this is why also the Dynamic Coalition on Human Rights and Principles in the Internet, of which I am a part, drew up a charter on human rights and principles for the Internet, where they put as number one, first article, the right to access to the internet, because it is a kind of precondition for the full enjoyment of most other rights. It's true that states have not recognized this so far. And when you look at the report of the Special Rapporteur on Freedom of Expression, Frank LaRue, he's a bit careful. Can this be already called a human right? No. But what you can do quite easily is you look at the Article 2 of the International Covenant on Economic, Social, Cultural Rights, and here the obligation on states is not to provide right from one day to the other. The obligation is only to achieve progressively the full realization of this right and even to accept international assistance in doing so. So the obligation is to do what the best endeavors, what you can reasonably do. That is the obligation on the state and maybe also on the business. And I think that's it.
Okay, thank you. I've got a comment over here and then you're next.
Now, yes. Yeah, okay, you. So my name is Eleonora Rabinovich. I'm also a lawyer working at the Association for Civil Rights in our I'm sorry. And I think that conceptually, I'm more inclined to consider that access to the internet is not a human right. But I think that the real question is not about considering access to the internet a human right or not. That's not so important, and maybe it's not so relevant, but I would like to gather with all the lawyers and not the lawyers here to see how can we go to court and ask the court to oblige the states to provide internet. And I think that we can do it using all the rights that we have in our international treaties and in our constitutions, for example, freedom of expression, freedom of education, access to education. And so I think that we really don't need to further this discussion so much, but we really need to find creative solutions and try to find how to demand to the state. And we have a lot of examples of this kind of public interest and strategic litigation in other cultural, economic, and even political rights, and we should use that experience and our international human rights standards to do that. So I think that we can do it.
Thank you. Can I get a show of hands of lawyers in the room? So there's a suggestion here that lawyers unite. So perhaps at the end, out in the corridor, we can have a discussion about the way in which the legal framework can be used in order to achieve rights through or ensuring that there's access in order to achieve those rights.
Maybe I don't want another meeting with the lawyers, but no.
Well, anyway, out in the corridor at the end. Okay. And then.
My name is Nikhat and I'm from Pakistan. I really don't want to get into the debate that whether access to internet is a human right or not. As a active user of internet, I believe that it's a basic human right. And before asking a question to Google, I want to ask that how many of us actually believe that internet is access to internet is a human right in this room?
You know, we could probably ask this question at the beginning, during the middle, and at the end. Can I get a sense of how many people think that it might be an emerging human right? And how many people are dead set against it?
I think it's a derived.
Yeah, so I think Google believes in the same way, because in Pakistan, YouTube has been blocked. It's more than a month now. And since I believe that it's my human right, access to internet, who is the responsible of my human right, of the violation of my human right? Is this the corporation who actually didn't listen to the Pakistani government, and who actually listened to the Libyan government and blocked the content, right? And is this my state is responsible, who actually doesn't listen to the citizens when it comes to internet freedom? So I'm pretty confused about it, that who is the responsible actor?
Okay.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. Can we get a response from Vint on the previous point and perhaps also this one? And then I'm going to turn to the permanent secretary. Secretary as well, looking at the obligation of the state and whether there's an opportunity to perhaps legislate for this right to access.
So first, let me remind you that the internet is an artifact, and it will probably be replaced by something else 10, 20, 30 years from now, maybe even sooner. And so I'm not denying the utility of the internet, plainly not. I wouldn't have spent my entire career working on it if I didn't believe in it. But it makes me nervous to pick a technology and imbue it with this feature, human right, knowing full well that it will be replaced by something else. I did want to, however, make one observation about either obligations or a decision to pursue a goal. In the United States, it's very common for the public library system to have computer terminals and with internet access, and those are made available to anyone who goes into the library, including homeless people who have no other way of getting access to information and maybe even making a case for solving problems. That's an example of a decision made by the library system. They're not obligated by any law to do that, but they concluded that among the things that libraries were intended for, that access to the internet and access to information was a very, very important additional means of serving that need. So again, I want to reiterate that denial of your access when the internet is theoretically available, you shouldn't be denied access, but I don't think that means it should be provided, guaranteed to you necessarily free of charge at home, for example. It's a business. It has to be supported somehow. So somehow all of its costs have to be paid.
So,
yes, in Kenya, for example, the right to information is constitutionally guaranteed. But it will be completely useless to say you have right to information if it is not in formats that people can access easily. And that's why even water in the days to come, for me to ensure that there is food security, there is food, the data that is available now must leverage on the cloud computing where we can be able to know that the water is clean. Water is a human rights issue, but it is clean water that we want. And internet may not be directly that way, but it is an essential part to human rights in the sense that for you to access the information that is guaranteed in the Constitution, it must be in the formats that you are able to access them. And a lot of information is being generated. That is why even the years to come, as Vin says, it could move in something else, but it will be an essential part of it. That is why we are legislating that information be in formats that majority of Kenyans can access it.
So this does raise the issue of, you know, is it a right unto itself or is it an enabler? And I think Amnesty International released a response actually to Vince position where they said that the means to access the right and the right are now indistinguishable, and therefore access to the internet is actually a right. They combine the means and the ends into one. I have another comment from the floor, and then this gentleman over here. And then we're going to remote participation. Thank you, Deborah.
Is my mic working?
It is, and just if you could be brief.
Sure, yeah. Okay. Larry Maggett from connectsafely.org. I came here actually with the same notion that Vint, that the internet was not necessarily a right. But the more I think about it, the more I realize that lack of access to the internet is similar to lack of access to education or healthcare. It is very difficult to function in society today, to get a job, to get health information, to travel without internet access. So it strikes me that there is a role for both the public sector and the private sector, just as there is a role even in countries unlike America that have national healthcare for private sector healthcare, if you want luxury healthcare. There's also a role for public sector, just as there are private schools, there's a role for public schools. So I do think, I agree with the permanent secretary, that there is a minimum service that ought to be provided to everyone, but there continues to be the possibility of luxury or high-speed service for those who want to pay for it.
Okay, so we have a comment here. then we're going to go to remote participation, and then back on the left.
Thank you very much. My name is Mikhail Komarov. I'm from National Research University Higher School of Economics from Moscow, Russia. Actually, I just wanted to emphasize and focus the discussion on the sentences which were told by Mr. Cerf, that we're not talking about human rights and we're not talking about access to the internet as a human right. We are talking about services which should be provided, you know, by the internet as itself, as a network. And actually, I just would like to add that we surely should just extend the description of, you know, particular human rights in terms of technological progress, than trying to provide new rights, which are just, you know, probably a part of technological progress. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Okay, so can we hear some comments from outside of the room? And maybe the panel can respond to these.
Hi, so we have a question from Walid Asakaf, who is an Arab journalist and online activist, and he's the founder and manager of the Al-Qasr for Internet Censorship, Mapping, and Circumvention. And his question is, he has found out the hard way that internet censorship and website filtering is hindering freedom of expression, and he's done research on this in the Arab world before and after the Arab Spring. And he found that access to the technology does not result in access to expression and tools that would allow expression. So his question is, where can the IGF be effective in censorship online, particularly in opinion, news, and social networking?
Does somebody want to take that question?
I think he's pointed up what I'd say is, I guess, a concerning trend from all the internet platforms, that the interest in from governments in managing the content that's available on global platforms is growing over time, not reducing, is our experience. And it seems to me from working in the political world that there is a fairly simple logic to it, which is that, you know, if you're in the business of politics and government, there are enlightened exceptions to this, but generally speaking, you have a very strong interest in those forms of mass communication that reach significant numbers of your population. So it seems to me like a side effect of rolling out a lot of broadband access in many countries is a growing interest of government in regulation of content that flows across those channels. The second part of the question, so that's, I think, the phenomenon we're experiencing is, oh my God, this thing is so powerful. You know, we're used to a degree of control over television and radio. This thing is now as powerful as television and radio. We are now worried, what are we going to do about it? And we've seen the reaction in various forms of legislation in different countries around the world. What could the IGF do about it? I think there is a... I think the best way to counter those moves, assuming one supports that view that we should keep those restrictions to a minimum, is very strong citizen activism. So we provide in many cases the tools that people can use to express their view to government, that in fact people are reasonably grown up, they're reasonably able to cope with a range of contentious content. That they're able to deal with, you know, in TV world, the equivalent of hundreds of channels, some of which have content that not everybody wants to view, as opposed to, you know, five channels of carefully managed content. And I think that debate has to take place between citizens and their governments. I mean, this is an area where governments, you know, absolutely have the power to make those decisions. I think IGF can be a forum where people organize to express their views to their governments about the kind of regime they're comfortable with.
Response from Vint, and then we'll move back to the audience.
So I think that's a very cogent analysis. Now, the interesting thing about the internet, of course, is that it doesn't really admit of national boundaries very well. It's a very global system, and it's very massive in terms of its capacity to make information available. Those of you who remember the history of copyright may remember that it was originally instituted so that the crown could prevent people from publishing things that were thought to be harmful to the crown. That's not the concept of copyright that we deal with today, although it has its own set of problems, but there was a separate session on that. So the problem here is making governments feel comfortable that open dialogue of the kind that we try to have here in the Internet Governance Forum in a multi-stakeholder model, that open dialogue is in fact not only safe, but it's actually important, especially in democratic societies.
Thank you. Up the back here on the left. Yep. We need a microphone for Pedro. Perhaps if there are any of the IGF staff here, we could have people standing. Yeah, okay. And passing the microphone around.
Thank you, Brett.
You can be next, sir. Yeah, madam, sorry.
My name is Pedro Alessandrade. I'm doing public policy and government affairs for Google in Latin America. I would like to change the conversations into which are the risks to consider internet as a right, as a human right. And I think that everybody here means well in terms of that we want more protection for the internet. The question if it's considering this a human right is the best way to achieve that. And the question here is, we talk about water, we talk about electricity, we talk about many things that usually are under the domain of the state. You know, the state has the obligation to provide, to control a natural resource and provide water. And if you look at the origin of the internet is not under the domain of the state. Has been created by the collaboration of different stakeholders, technical community, private sector, civil society. So we might be putting this at risk in some way. We might telling the governments, okay, now internet is under your domain, you have the obligation to provide access or to guarantee access. And I'm a little bit concerned about that internet could be treated as a public utility in some way. And you know that public utilities could be given to private sector for exploitation, but also could be taken back. And we can end up sometimes in this kind of situation where we have the feeling that this has been granted, but maybe it has been granted in a limited way. So I think that this is a big concern in terms of when we characterize this, and I think that it's a catalyzer for human rights enjoyment. That doesn't mean that this shouldn't be protected, as we protect the right of free movement of people, but we don't say that the roads are a human right, but we take care of the roads so that people can cross the different countries. So I think that we need to stick with those analogies. We need to protect the net so everybody can enjoy all the rights that the net provides. But I don't know, we have to be careful in which is going to be the role of the governments.
Okay.
On this.
I think we'll get a response from the government on the panel.
I think this is one of the contentious issues in the lead up to Dubai as to who would put up the infrastructure. Some operators are saying that they can't put it when content providers are running on it. In Kenya, for example, we adopted a different strategy in terms of infrastructure development, which reduces the capex on the operators. And I think going forward is going to be the best model where the government does the investment like we do in the roads, and whoever runs on the roads, it doesn't matter. That would solve the issue that is being contentious as we move to Dubai.
So you're not in support of the Aetna proposal? Okay. There's a lady up here first, and then that gentleman there. And are there any other further questions from remote? I'm sure there are. We'll come back to you.
Okay. Yes, I'm Kirsty Hughes from Index on Censorship, the International Freedom of Expression organization. I think we may be a little bit at risk here of confusing political and economic rights, whether they're public or private sector. Maybe we should just get back to the basics of human rights, as I think the Permanent Secretary, among others, has been talking about, and remember that the Universal Declaration of Human Rights covers social and economic rights as well as political rights, and that's why so many big development organizations like one I used to work for these days talk about rights-based programming precisely for things like water and the basics of life. So I would tend in the direction of amnesty to say it's very hard to distinguish access and the exercise of that right. And perhaps for a moment, think about the offline world, because it doesn't just hang there in the sky that we all have free expression if we're lucky enough to live in a country that respects rights. You may still have, even say in the UK, you've got illiteracy. You may not have access to the media or access to the arts or access to digital. So I think to say we all support freedom of expression, but we're very unsure about access is perhaps a little bit confused. And if these two things are not identical, they're certainly getting very close. Thank you.
Thank you. Sir in the corner. Yep, coming to the right over here. I know that you're there.
Thank you. My name is Pepe Huerta. I'm from NGO Meta from Chile. This lady took the words out of my mouth, but no, thank you. The thing is, we are kind of mixing up a couple of concepts that are really weird to define between a human right and a constitutional right. Constitutional rights it doesn't mean that a constitutional right is a human right. And human rights are part of the core essence of the human being, you know, and we all love the internet and the all development that has come with it, but it's not part of the core sense of the human being. So what a constitutional right does is create actions for the people to demand the enforcement of a public policy that could be accessed from public outlets like libraries, as Mr. Cerf says, or I don't know, local governments, etc. And considering internet as a human right, it will bring other huge problems for lawyers and interpretations. Because think about this, at least there's a lot of books and literature about conflicts between one human right and another. For example, the human right of life and the human right of freedom of a cult. You know, there's a family that will not accept a blood transfusion because it goes against their religion and they prefer to die, you know? And how this will apply in a conflict with internet as a human right. It doesn't work that way.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for raising that distinction. And I think we've seen in many countries like Finland and Estonia, for instance, there is actually a right to the internet or a right to a certain level of speed of the internet that's been legislated for. And some of it, there's also been some interpretation, I think, within the French Constitutional Court. It doesn't necessarily designate it as a human right, but has it either as a constitutional right or a legal right. And I think these are variations and gradations of the concept of right. Okay, so let's move to the right side. Sir, up in the back corner with the microphone.
My name is Al from Kenya. The main thing that I wanted to address myself to is this, that I put the question up on Facebook and on Google Plus, and asked the question, and the general consensus over there is that it's an enabler to rights, because information and freedom of expression is right, and therefore the internet sort of enables that. However, I come from the perspective, a more utilitarian perspective, that basically says that if these are the rights that we need to provide and we need to ensure that everybody has access to, then we have to address ourselves to the motivation of why we would consider it a right. If we did declare the internet as a human right, one of the things that would happen is that, as my friends there said, it would necessarily become a political imperative for governments to implement it, either by providing infrastructure or by providing whatever means, so that every citizen has access to it. Now, what does that mean? It means that every citizen, as a result of that, can access all of the rest of those rights because of the fact that they can share information, they have freedom of expression, and more importantly, they can access data relating to problems that face them as individuals. So for me, human right, absolutely.
Excellent point. Thank you very much. Alan, can I get a response from you? We've talked about like codifying, designating, identifying, acknowledging this thing as a human right. How does actually a human right become a human right?
So one way that a human right becomes a human right is, as I previously mentioned, is that through states coming together and concluding a treaty in which they say, well, this is so important to us that we think that this should be a right that is that everybody's entitled to. So I mentioned a few general covenants that have been set up, but there are other covenants which are very specific. So it doesn't always have to be something very general. There's a convention for the protection of children. There's a convention for the benefit of people with disabilities. And for example, that specific convention includes a provision which states that people with disabilities should also have the ability to access the internet. So there are actually already all sorts of examples in treaties between states in which they make it very clear that access to the internet is something that is important. If we look at a more general treaty, one that has been referred to by Wolfgang before, and which is regarded to be quite well recognized for economic and social rights, there is an article there, Article 15, which states the state parties to the present covenant recognize the right of everyone to enjoy the benefit of scientific progress and its applications. Well, if the internet is not that, then what is it? So there are all sorts of ways in which we actually have tried to make already clear in all sorts of ways when states came together that the internet is so important, or that science is so important, or that all sorts of media are so important that want everyone to be able to access them. I just want to get back to the point that Al made before, that it's really important that we think of a national context in which somebody accesses the internet. If we think of a situation of a government, and the Permanent Secretary also mentioned it, a government that interacts with its citizens primarily through the internet, then we also need to understand, well, it is kind of essential that citizens are able to interact with the government in an equal manner. If we say that part of the citizenry cannot access the internet and another part can, that is quite disconcerting. So we're speaking about issues for people who maybe lack the economic means to access the internet. That is something that can be a concern. We're speaking about people who might have disabilities and for that reason have difficulties. We should keep that into account. We're also talking about literacy issues, also very important. So all these sort of things I think are very important when we are speaking about right to access, that we need to keep them in mind and making sure that we have a right that allows everyone to access it. And also, as one of the remote participants alluded to, not only access to technology, but also access the internet in a way that is open, in a way that it allows access to the full internet and not a restricted one.
Thanks. I'll just get a quick response here directly to the disability issue. So just briefly, if it's okay, because it's a...
Actually, I was surprised it didn't come up earlier. So my name is Shadia Bozara. I work with the Web Accessibility Initiative of the World Wide Web Consortium. And the aspect, the UN Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities does put access to internet as, or access to information, including access on the internet, as a human right. I think the main thing was access to information is what's in the foreground, because the internet is really a unique opportunity for people with disabilities to have equal access in society, something that is not available in the physical environment. So I'm not a lawyer, so I don't know exactly where that stands, but I think in the idea of balancing where it's available, I think it needs to be made available to people with disabilities for sure.
Thank you very much. Vint.
This is actually a very important point. In some parts of the world, in the U.S. in particular, there's an Americans with Disabilities Act, which speaks now to a lot of online environments. I can tell you, as president of the Association for Computing Machinery, I sent out a recent essay asking why is it so hard to provide access to online information for people with various kinds of disabilities, deafness, vision problems. It turns out it's technically hard to do, but we have to do it, so I'm very supportive.
Excellent. Okay, so can we move back to the end of the room? Who has the microphone at this point? You do. So very briefly, if it's okay, because we've only got another 15 or 20 minutes. We have a lot of people who want to speak. Go on.
Okay, this is Norbert Bolo, Swiss Open Systems User Group, and I wanted to bring up the point of whether it's access to the internet in the sense of international internet or access to some intranet. And from my perspective, the main point is the balance of rights countries want to fight terrorism, countries want to enforce copyright, but I think it's even more important to have access to the real, true international internet. And if we assert that as a human right, we get our priorities straight. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Yep, up here. Can you pass the microphone over to the lady over there? Thank you. Go ahead.
Now, yes. Do you listen to me?
Yes.
I'm Veridiana Alimonti. I'm from Brazil, from a defense institute, the Consumer Defense Institute. And I'd like to go back to the main controversy here, and I would like to agree with the sir over there that human rights is about the core essence of the human beings. But I think that if we understand access of internet as part of communication rights, right to communicate, then we will see that this is part of the core of a human being. We are human beings because we can communicate, because we interact. So thinking about communication today is thinking about internet access. Internet is capable of potentializing this, and then we cannot just think at internet as a technology. Of course, it can maybe obsolete one day, but today this is the main way to communicate with other persons. And I think right to communicate is also different from freedom of expression, because freedom of expression has a more negative step about state action. And right to communicate, there are a positive step. State has to do public policies to guarantee it. And so regarding democratic countries, of course, I'll have to disagree with the fear that Pedro commented, because recognizing internet access as an object of public policies is not to say that you have to have a state-owned company providing the service, right? You are saying that a state has to be worried with this and draw public policies and rule some part of the and rule some part of the company's action also.
Okay.
So what I want to say is that public policies is important, and even though for most part of the telecommunication companies or service providers or application providers, this is a business, this is also a right. So if you have private schools, if you have private health insurance companies, this is it doesn't make health or education a business.
Okay.
It's still a right. So I think we should think in this perspective. Thank you.
I was wondering why she couldn't hear me, because she doesn't have her headphones on. Sorry to keep interrupting you. Let's hear from Elvin from Azerbaijan on any of the comments that have been made before.
I definitely agree with the public policy side of the of your comment. I think this is this should not be thought as a linear process. I mean, fundamentally, that is a responsibility only of the state. It is not only the responsibility of the state. I think there should be public, civil society, and private partnership instead of, but also public and private partnerships. But the state has to provide a policy in the country to provide the access for each individual. As, for example, ICCPR, International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights, and Article 25, it stipulates that the right to access to the public service. We have now internet government, internet governance, or e-governance, sorry. If we are not able to interact with the officials over the internet, but there is a policy of e-governance, that means that we cannot have any access. I mean, we cannot use this right. It means that it's an indirect or direct violation of our right to access, to make the governments accountable through internet. It also creates an... It also... creates another question, like neoliberal economy and social democratic economy, social democratic state. In neoliberal economies, the state only creates the opportunities for such kind of rise to get evolved and to get developed and improved. But in this context, I think the state is the is only the provider of the situations. I mean, the state is the only the producer of the policy and also other financial and other technical matters, but in together with the private sector. In social democratic societies, maybe internet access could be considered, could be fundamentally considered a human right. But since the question, it is out of the scope of our discussion here, civil society's role specifically must be underlined. If the state is not is not responsible to educate all the citizens through its education programs, I'm not talking about the schools because it's already taken for granted that it is the obligation of the state, but civil society must take the role to educate the citizen through non-formal education, and at the same time telecom companies and private sector together with the state has to finance the access, which is underlined by the public policy of the state to provide the access for each citizen.
Okay, thank you. I've got a comment from here and then I'm coming back over there. You can use this.
Thanks. I think rights is many things to many different people. To lawyers, it's about law. To activists, it's about, you know, something that you mobilize and you really get people to think about change. And to some people, it's really like a matter of life and death. If I have the right, then, you know, I will fight to death for it. And saying that, so now we're thinking about, okay, so why are we talking about rights together with access? In what way will thinking about access to the internet as in the framework of rights help us to be able to get more access? So whose responsibility is it? And I've been hearing it here and there, but it's come up like, okay, so this makes it the state's obligation. And then it's the state's obligation, so we as citizens can demand the state, la la la, and then it puts us in a particular kind of power by binary. I can go to the court if the state doesn't do it. And is this helpful to me as a civil society actor who really wants to provide open, meaningful access that is free from censorship and all forms of other kinds of discriminatory way, whether it's disabilities or sexualities or gender and so on, is this going to help me? And I've been thinking and thinking about this, and I feel that actually the right to information is going to help me, the right to association is going to help me, the right to assembly is going to help me, the right to benefit from scientific progress is going to help me. And I think it will also help me to demand a kind of, I mean, we talked about censorship and we always think that it's by the state, but it's also by people like Google and Facebook. So how then this thinking about rights helped me to also demand a free and open internet when censorship from Google or Facebook happens? So I think these are the things that I would like to just explore a little bit more in this conversation.
Yep, okay, great. Awesome. So, okay.
I would like to just make, I understand Mr. Cerf's concern about locking ourselves into a technology by the means of a human right. But my question would be then to anybody in the table, perhaps to Mr. Cerf, if they find in the human rights framework a specific tool to help us out with the problem of having an inclusive technology. Because I have the feeling that talking about access to information or access to freedom of expression or communication rights doesn't allow us to secure the technology that might come in the future with the same characteristics of the internet. I mean, with what we have today, we cannot start a radio station, we cannot start a broadcaster. So the concern I feel we might go ahead on the road is just ending up with nothing at all because we didn't want to get locked up in a technology.
So we've got, I think many people are concerned about that the technology will change. And and so it's not the right to the right to access to the internet. What about the right to access this term, which I haven't heard before, inclusive technology?
Waiting for another response from this side. I will tell you what I am most comfortable with, Mr. Chairman. I'm most comfortable with the fundamental notion of the right of access to information, assembly, and the like, some of the things that were mentioned in an intervention earlier. I see these technologies as enablers, and we should focus on enabling all of those rights to the best of our ability. As time goes on, we'll find new ways to do that. And I think failure to move ahead and find better ways of instituting those rights, or let's say, defending against the inhibition of access to those technologies. This I agree with. I think if it's available and you're denied access to it, that's fundamentally a human rights problem. But I do get all tangled up in the obligation side. One other comment, if you force the government to be the provider of this stuff, you may be making a big mistake if the government decides that it's going to provide you with its version of whatever that access is. That may not be what you want.
I do think it's important to note at that point that when something is designated as a positive right, it actually is incumbent upon the state to take positive steps towards the realization of that right. It's not an automatic, sort of 0 to 100 style approach. And so, it's progressive realization in a sense. Richard, did you want to respond?
I think what we're excited about and why we're here is it's really about having access to potential. So it is the potential to assemble, the potential to express. And where the concerns come in is if that potential is somehow narrowed down. And just to respond directly to the question about platforms and what platforms do is, we don't represent that entire potential. We represent, I think we, in a way, what we do is we kind of stick with social norms. But what the potential of an open internet allows is it allows people not to conform to the social norms that exist on our platforms. And we would absolutely die in a ditch to defend people's rights not to conform with the social norms that we may create on our individual platforms. Take a very obvious example, nudity. If you do or don't allow nude images, if you don't allow nude images on your platform, as we don't, that's massive censorship. Thousands of people every day, millions of people try and upload nude images, which we censor. Now, there's no kind of human rights question there. In some cases, it's not a legal question. It's a question of the social norm for our platform is a clothed norm. And there are plenty of other platforms where there are unclothed norms. But the important thing is that... unclothed norms, yeah. But the important thing is that there, you know, for our way, there is the potential to create both of those. But the idea that there should only be one norm, and the norm is that, you know, everybody has to allow everything, I think that, again, I don't actually think that helps expand access or expand the range of services. In some ways, it narrows them down. And the risk then is that legislation then follows. The way you would get those sort of universal norms enforced is through lowest common denominator. Rather than, you know, this expansive internet. So I say we take full responsibility for the decisions we make, being transparent about the norms that we operate on our platforms, and they're very clear for everyone to see, and we try and explain those. But we're not saying that people can't create other platforms and other spaces that don't conform to our norms. And in fact, we absolutely defend their right to do so in the context of an open internet.
So,
okay, so Nabil Ben Amar from Morocco. So I would try to raise the problem and the issue of mobile internet access. So if we think that internet access is a human right, so we know that the future of internet is mobile. So how can it be with the fees actually of smartphones? We need smartphones to be able to access to the internet mobile access. So I think that it should be a consensus about smartphone fees to at least think about internet access as an emerging human right. What do you think about this?
Let's get another comment here and then one here and then we'll move back to the panel and I think then we'll round up. Yeah.
So we've heard a lot of references to human rights, but one of the issues I have with it actually being written out as a human right rather than coming out from other rights, is that if you look at Article 19, while that's really great article, you look at the restrictions of it and how it's being interpreted, for example, in Egypt, is defamation is viewed as one of the restrictions because, and then look at cybersecurity and these other issues. So while I'm happy to say that I view it as my right to have access to the internet as part of my right to free expression, political engagement, and cultural engagement. I don't want a state, and this is one of the things I keep saying, is I don't like government interference in the internet. It should be, and creating a law, whether international or national law, that interferes with this ecosystem will be problematic. Because no matter what, states have agendas, and they're going to come to the table and say, that's great, we'd like X restriction. And I came in here thinking, yes, definitely, you know, the internet was a human right. And as I heard this, I kept thinking of the kill switch in Egypt. I know that Egyptian government will say, for national security reasons, we need to be able to kill the switch. Or for whatever reason, we're going to want this kill switch to stay in. And then we saw what happened on January 28th, where it was great. Everyone went down to the street and had a great outcome in the end. But still, I think it's really, really problematic to write out this right, because what are the caveats to it, or what are governments going to say, what reservations they have to it?
Thank you. Interesting point. And great to see that you came in here thinking that access to the internet was a human right and changed, and the fellow over there came thinking that it wasn't, and now it is. Last comment from you.
Now it's on. Okay. So what, I'd love to see another vote taken, but what I'm hearing is that we're not really talking about a new human right. It's the right to what the internet affords that's a human right, regardless of how the technology that affords it changes or what the technology is. You know, you can access the internet on music players and game devices and tablets and cell phones or mobile phones. And, you know, we'll always, I think from now on, we'll have new devices that will enable access to the internet. And I don't think we'll have to say that governments have to provide mobile phones, but government has to be to allow the affordance of the human rights we have already established through whatever means. And the means will always be changing. But I'd love to see a vote on whether or not we really need a new human right. Because I came in saying, yeah, it should be. And now I'm thinking, we already have these rights and the internet allows us access.
So one thing that I was thinking about actually on the way in was whether access to the internet is a human right and whether it was an enabler. And I was thinking that the internet, you know, enables us to information. Then I thought, maybe the internet is information. Maybe the internet is education. Maybe the internet is healthcare. Maybe the internet is actually all the rights. Maybe it's a super right. Maybe it's the most important right of all. That's what I was thinking on the way in. So that's my final comment, but let's hear from the rest of the panel just to go around. And then I'd also, once we've finished, Access and Fight for the Future are launching a video on the ITU, so people who would like to stay, I'm going to show that video for 3 minutes at the end of the panel.
One thing I want to discount is that internet came from heaven and there was no history. It is a channel of communication, which there was radio, which government controlled, and propaganda, TV, government controlled and propaganda. So internet came and removed that propaganda and has enabled interactivity, where we are able to interact. If we look at it as a communication channel, then it is not a fad. It is a technological development that we are looking at, that the next level would accommodate this and even do better than where we have reached at the moment. So I still think that it's a significant human rights issue, because this is where we are going to create empowerment of the people, whether in healthcare or education or any other area. That's my final conclusion.
And Vint, from you, and then your final comment, if you'd like to make one.
Well, I want to observe something from Alejandro, who points out that we don't take votes in the IGF, so this has got to be a poll, not a vote.
Oh, okay.
And
we're
second,
polling.
Second, universal access programs may be the key to solving the problem. We all want more internet, and we want the benefits that come with it, but we can do that without declaring it a human right. All we have to do is get busy and build it.
Richard?
So I think we're primarily, or many of us, I think, in this room will be concerned with this issue because we're concerned about the stress points, the points at which governments in particular are stressed about something on the internet and are considering limiting access, either to individuals or to entire regions. And so I think my colleague from Egypt's point about the kill switch, when those stress points come, they're going to weigh two things up. They're going to weigh up, you know, the negative impact of cutting off access versus the benefit of reducing the civil unrest or whatever it is. Which is going to weigh heavier? The fact that they're transgressing this right of access to the internet, or the fact that they are transgressing people's right to access markets, to access healthcare, to access education, and so on? And I actually think the things that weigh really heavily are the things that interrupt every aspect of people's daily lives. The right to the internet may be a nice addition to that, but it's not going to be the thing that stops them flicking the kill switch. It's all the other stuff.
Yeah, just to get back on the kill switch comment, I also think that it is actually a very important reason why we are talking here today. The fact that that happened in January 2011 in Egypt was a reason for many people to think about, well, access to the internet is so important, there should be protection for people, so this cannot happen again. So that is part of the idea that we're talking about, the right to access the internet, in my view, that gives it that merit. I think also that in many ways, and as others have noted, we can already say that there is such a thing as a right to access the internet, in the same way that you and I have a right to watch television if we want to, or go on the road, as Pedro also alluded to. So the right to access is embedded in all sorts of ways, and whether it should be a recognized separate right is another issue in itself.
So, thanks. Yeah. Thanks, Al. Last comment from you.
Yeah, basic argument, different arguments were here that whether the state should be the guarantor of the right to access the internet or prohibitor. Well, if the state gets prohibitor of the internet, that it means that state must also be the guarantor of the right to access the internet.
Okay, so let's have that poll. Those who think that access to the internet is not a right.
Does not need to be defined as a separate.
Yeah. Is not defined.
Does not need to be defined as a separate.
It's all in the question that you asked. Those who think that it actually is a human right. And those who think it's an emerging right. A lot of people didn't put up their hand. Okay, thanks very much. People who'd like to stay for the launch of the video, be great if you can. It's a few minutes long. If you can play that now, that would be great, up on the screen. Thanks, everyone. Thanks for coming, and thanks to the panel.